Well, last night, Clemson opened the season about as well as you can with a 5-0 win over the Bearcats of Cincinnati. Davis Sharp started things going in Clemson's direction. He was followed up by four strong innings of relief from Matt Clark. Together, they didn't let Cincinnati scratch. The big hit, a Jonathan French three-run homer. Tigers and Bearcats, game two is coming up next. And welcome in to a bright, sunny Doug Kingsmore Stadium, where Clemson and Cincinnati set to get back at it this afternoon as the Tigers look to win a series after a great start for Clemson in the Friday night opener. There you see the line score. Cincinnati, a very empty line score with just a couple of hits. Sharp and Clark, brilliant on the mound for Clemson. The two freshmen, French and Grice, making their respective debuts and playing about as well as one could expect for a couple of freshmen. Hi, everybody. Alongside Marty Cleary, I'm William Quackenbush. Marty, it's always good to get an opening day win, but Monty Lee, Clemson know that if you don't play well today, it doesn't matter nearly as much.
Well, the pitcher set down the gauntlet for the rest of the weekend, and that's going to be a real challenge on them. I know they're going to come out fired up and ready to match that.
Oh, no question. Here's a look at the starting lineup for Cincinnati, and the Bearcats, well, they're looking to get some hits before two outs. All three of their base runners yesterday, in fact, came with two outs. You see a lineup that looks very similar from yesterday. Scott Guggins tried his best to get the lineup fired up. Nothing was really working for him yesterday.
No, and I know he's telling them, quality at-bats, put the ball in play. Let's see if we can put some pressure on them and crack them.
Yeah. Tigers had eight ground ball outs yesterday. Infield defense was outstanding. Here is that defense from Clemson. Only change from yesterday's lineup. Briar Hawkins in at first base to replace Caden Grice, who will pitch tomorrow's game as one of two freshmen in Clemson's weekend rotation. And there you see right in the middle, Ty Olenchuk, a freshman right-hander. Monty Lee says this is the best strike thrower on his staff, which is awfully high praise considering we saw two good strike throwers in Sharp and Clark last night.
Yeah, 15 strikeouts, one walk. Wow, that's hard to beat. However, that's what you want to do early in a season. Cincinnati hasn't seen a lot of live pitching. Get out there, throw strikes, get them out of the innings as fast as possible, and never let them gain momentum.
Olenchuk, a stud quarterback in the high school ranks at Dutch Fork, a native of Irmo, and now making his collegiate debut. I know it's not quite a full crowd, but a sellout crowd of 1280 here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium. Marty, the butterflies trying to calm down in your debut. How difficult is that going to be for Olenchuk this afternoon?
Well, you have to watch it, right? Sometimes you can overthrow because you're so excited, the adrenaline's flowing, and that's something you need to watch. If you get through of an inning or two, everything tends to settle down, but you want to try and just breathe, relax, and go back to what you've always done, just throw strikes.
Here's Joey Bellini to start us off, and Olenchuk deals up and in. Ball one, first pitch at 3:03 this afternoon. Beautiful sunny skies, not a cloud in the sky today. That ball's hit in the air, foul.
And he's throwing low 90s, and you can see just a little bit behind the pitcher's velocity right now, and that's going to probably be the tail of the tale for a while till they get a groove going on and see live pitching.
Bellini, one of several grad transfers we'll see on this Cincinnati roster. There's a strike. Olenchuk, a heavy fastball guy. You're going to see a lot of that. That one hit 93 right on the corner.
Yeah, and he got a little bit right there. That was a little bit off, but early in the season, he's throwing strikes in the zone, so make the hitter swing.
Breaking ball miss there, 2-2. Yeah, talking to Monty Lee earlier today, he said, look, Olenchuk may get hit a little bit, and we got to make plays behind him because he does throw so many fastballs. If he can get some swing and misses on that breaking ball, it's going to make him even that much more difficult. Ball's shot the other way, and Bellini staying alive, still 2-2.
His first breaking ball was pretty sharp. It was just outside. That one was a hanger and could have been trouble, and you saw he had a pretty good rip at that one.
Bellini's job, see pitches. It'll lead off the ball game for the Bearcats. And he saw strike three right there. That's one heck of a start for Ty Olenchuk as he paints the corner again.
Yeah, it's not only did he paint it, it was at 94 miles an hour. Pretty tough on a guy who's probably just coming outside and getting his first look at live pitching.
You see another look. First career strikeout for Olenchuk there, and he hit that spot a couple times. And you mentioned if you can get that call a little bit off the plate, off the outside, that can help you settle in just a little bit better.
Absolutely, and you want to take advantage of that. Umpire starts feeling that you got control, he gives it to you.
Stapp pops it up shallow center. This is James Parker, shallow outfield, will make the catch. Parker back in the lineup today after he got hit on his non-throwing hand or wrist, and I know took some swings in the cage earlier today. Monty Lee said he's good to give it a go, and I'm really glad he's back in the lineup today. Here's Ryan Nicholson. He had one of the two hits yesterday. He actually got the hit in the first inning with nobody aboard and two outs off of Davis Sharp yesterday.
Looks like a big, strong hitter. Try to be relaxed. Make sure he gets it, the ball over the plate for you.
Nicholson, a sophomore from Louisville, went to St. Xavier in Cincinnati. You can tell there's some pop in his bat. Olenchuk right there. Again, he's undeterred. He's not trying to mess around with hitters here. A little bit low there. He falls behind. Infield has shifted way over. Got the second baseman Gallo on the outfield grass, well into the outfield as a matter of fact. And now the count's even at 2-2. And again, he finds himself in an even count. A chance to throw an out pitch here.
Yeah, he can throw anything he wants at this point because he's been really hammering the fastball. So if he throws the breaking ball here, good chance he's not ready for that.
Tigers waiting on Nicholson to pull the ball. He hits it in the air. That should end the inning. A long run from center field for Bryce Teodosio, who makes the catch. An easy 1-2-3 inning for Ty Olenchuk. Tigers trying to back him with some runs when we return after this. There, looking at Clemson's dugout, the batting order looks very similar from the one that got five runs across last night. Marty, this a very young baseball team and a young lineup here. Seven right-handers against a left-hand starter we'll talk about here in just a little bit.
Yeah, and that always gives you a slight advantage. And again, if you're not used to throwing, you want to take advantage of trying to get that first good fastball over there. Make sure it's over the plate. Try not to chase pitches and put pressure on that pitcher.
And a good defense from Cincinnati, we mentioned several times yesterday. This is a team that was making all the plays in the field. That one early error, but Eric Santiago looked as advertised at third base. The outfield, particularly Murray in center, had a really good start to the season. One change to catcher, Tanner Holen, and he's going to be catching throws from Dean McCarthy. There you see him, a grad transfer out of Elon. This was a critical piece in the Phoenix's CAA regular season championship from 2 years ago. So doesn't really have much of a background in a Bearcats uniform, but he's thrown plenty of innings at the collegiate level.
And they need to bring that experience. He's going to have to throw strikes, but also mix his pitches up to beat this kind of Clemson lineup.
5'11", 195, the measurements for McCarthy. And coincidentally, exact measurements for Blake Wright, who was 0-for-5 last night with a couple of strikeouts. The one thing he did well at the plate was he did work deep into counts. Just couldn't win a lot of those battles. And a first pitch strike. Good spot with 91 there from McCarthy. Wright got a piece of it, fouled it away. Down in the count, 0-2. Tough spot for a freshman against a veteran lefty on the mound.
Yeah, he's set up for any pitch right now, and they'll probably try and chase him off the plate maybe a little bit or run it in on his hands.
Let's see where he goes here on the 0-2 delivery. And Wright fouls another one off.
And that's what you want to see from that leadoff guy. He doesn't have to do everything, but, man, battle, make that pitcher have to throw a bunch of pitches, and don't be an easy out.
Yeah, Wright saw at least five pitches in three of his five plate appearances yesterday. There he checks and doesn't go. And a look at that. He held up.
Yeah, I think he held his hands.
First base umpire Doug Vines making the quick call down there. McCarthy looking for a punch out here against Wright. Ground ball down the line toward the corner. And Blake Wright's rounding first. He's headed to second base. And an easy leadoff double, and he is fired up.
The two-strike pitch right there was a little bit more over the plate than I think he would have liked it. And it allowed him to hit it right down the line. Came inside, but not enough.
You see it right down the chalk. He snuck it in right over the bag. And now Clemson's got options. Tigers were 2-for-10 early in the game with runners in scoring position. They finally got that hit with runners in scoring position they were looking for to drive in a run with French's three-run homer. Ended up 3-for-15 as a team last night. Here's Brewer. He walked three times yesterday. Runner leading. Brewer, grounder to the right side. That'll at least advance the runner to third. You love seeing that from a two-hitter.
Yeah, he did his job. I mean, you'd like to push it through for a base hit, but for sure you want to pull that ball, allow the runner to go from second to third with less than two outs, and put yourself in a great chance to try and push a run across right off the bat.
Now Elijah Henderson, bit of a rough start for him. He got hit by a pitch, was 0-for-3. But somebody that Monty Lee and his staff have a ton of confidence in. And that's going to get the run home. He's going to ground out, but an RBI and good situational baseball gets the Tigers ahead 1-0 here in the first.
And you saw the excitement even on Henderson. He knew that wasn't a hit, but he knew he had gotten a run in. And early in a ball game where you already have won one game the day before, nothing more exciting for a young player.
And how about this from Wright? Again, some freshman exuberance as he crosses the plate. And there's Henderson. He knows, again, he's 0 for the season, but he knows he did his job right there.
That'll get praise from the coach, too.
So the Tigers work a leadoff double around to score, and now James Parker will bat. He grounds to the shortstop. Good play charging to get the out. Bellini to Nicholson. Tigers lead by one as we head to the second here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium. There's a look at the Bearcats. Head coach Scott Guggins, his fourth season there. We talked about them as the defending AAC champions. That's so weird to say when you see a 2019 in front of the title, but it is what it is. And he led the Bearcats to their first NCAA tournament appearance in 45 years. Now, that's quite a feat for a guy who's still really trying to build a program in Cincinnati.
Yeah, not easy up north, and a lot of good teams up there. You got to pick and choose, try and get players, teach them right, get them working hard, get them on the field, and let's see what happens.
Square to bunt and taking a strike. The cleanup hitter, Jace Mercer. Most everybody was 0-for-3 or 0-for-4 last night. Jace was among them. A couple of strikeouts. And Olenchuk's way ahead of him, nothing and two. He's just rearing back and humming it in there right now, Marty.
Yeah, he squared around to bunt because he sees it, that whole left side. If he just gets it on the ground at all, he would be safe. But early in the year type situation, sometimes you don't want to give up your swings yet, especially on your number four hitter.
0-2, up high. It'll be Mercer, Santiago, and Merritt here for the Bearcats as you see the infield alignment with three to the right. Obviously becoming more and more in vogue all the time, and we see particularly for left-handers on the ground. That ball lifted in the air to right. Brewer's got it well played. Out number one.
Olenchuk firing fastballs. Nobody's really hit it square so far. That one right there carried a little bit, but it never sounded like it was really hit that hard.
Wind's blowing across it there. At times it may help it out. At times it may knock it down if you hit it to the right center or right field part of the ballpark. Here's first pitch swing at Santiago, and this looks like Pierce Gallo's ball to take, and it is, and a quick two outs here in the second behind Olenchuk.
Pitcher's best friend, that first pitch, making out of it, so looks to make potential quick inning for him.
Now here's Griffin Merritt. Left fielder, a junior out of Cincinnati, 6'2", 205. Boy, right down the middle, 94. That might be his best fastball today right there.
It's right at it, and he looks really smooth. It's not a full effort type look when he throws it. Just smooth and easy, and it explodes to the plate.
Tried to come with a breaking ball that time.
Hey, win this count right here, baby.
And that's a hard thing when you're throwing fastball after fastball and fastball to try and get a feel on a not much humidity out there and that ball slick. It's hard to really get the spin right.
And there he got it. One and two. Right on cue.
That one had the spin. You'll see it bite down and away, and there was no chance that hitter was going to be able to get contact on that one.
Just off the inside corner. Pretty good job by French to make it look close.
Yeah, and he was setting his target. He wanted it up and kind of a middle of the plate, and he got it bored down and in. And that's where the umpire sometimes will be looking for it someplace and not really ready to call a strike.
Popped up. Olenchuk can't find it. James Parker can, and he makes the catch. And the side is retired. Another 1-2-3 inning for Olenchuk. The Tigers coming back to bat when we return. Well, Clemson a 1-0 lead here in the bottom of the second inning. They got that run playing small ball. There's nothing small ball about what Jonathan French did last night with a three-run bomb that really busted the game open.
He drove that. That's deep out there to hit that ball that far early in the season. Well done.
Freshman catcher. First pitch he sees from McCarthy, and that's fouled straight back, 0-1.
French looks real comfortable. That ball was in there, and he took a good hack at it. And just straight back, just missed it by hair.
You see, well put together, 5'10", 225. Just missed that one as well, nothing in two. Clemson really wanted to work hard last night to make the starter, Evan Shauver, throw pitches. Today, a lot of first pitch swings, a lot of second pitch swings we've seen so far against the lefty McCarthy.
Well, they've been good pitches. They've not swinging anything bad, and that's a good at-bat.
That one was certainly not one of the better pitches we've seen from McCarthy today as it bounces away.
Yeah, neither pitcher's really established that second pitch so far. They've been throwing strikes with their fastballs, but really not putting much danger on the hitter with the second pitch.
Ground ball, nice play. Santiago in the hole throws him out.
You could see the smoothness in the way he approaches the ball. His hands are real clean and good. Just real smooth. I like what I see in that.
And Santiago preseason all AAC, and he hit over 300 last year for, of course, a small sample size, but for the first time in his career to go along with the glove at third, an awfully good combination. Here's Briar Hawkins. Last night's DH, now at first. There's a good backdoor breaking ball.
Yeah, if he can start hitting with that, a little change up now and then, you'll start getting these hitters off stride. Really backdoored it right there. No way to, you don't want to swing at that one. Let's put it that way as a hitter.
Ball is ripped to center right at the center fielder Murray for the second out. He knows he was positioned about exactly perfect. Two up and two down for the Tigers here in the bottom of the second. Pierce Gallo had a couple of good at-bats yesterday. Had a walk and a hit, scored a run. One of those so-called super freshmen that actually debuted last year but didn't lose the year of eligibility.
McCarthy seems to be settling down a little bit, getting a little more comfortable out there.
You mentioned the secondary pitches. When you're making your debut like this, seems like it's not an automatic that you even establish the fastball, but getting those secondary pitches, that feels like just a different level of difficulty entirely, particularly when it's cold and when it's early.
Cold and low humidity is the hardest thing to do to kind of get the right spin and not let it slip out of your hand and hang up in the strike zone. So fastball is much easier to control. And early in the lineup, you know, they've only haven't seen you once. It's good to go fastball primarily. That's great. You just don't want to get stuck on that, not have a breaking ball or a changeup later on after they've seen you twice. Now you're in trouble.
Four-pitch walk of Gallo. I remember having a conversation one time with former Clemson pitcher Matthew Crownover, and he said, you know, if I can get one time through the order with my fastball, he said, I'm going to go deep in the game because I still got two pitches that nobody's seen yet. And if I can go the second time through only using a curveball or a changeup, then forget it. I'm going seven.
And it's hard to do that. You think, well, that makes sense. Okay, do that. But you get two strikes and your competitive nature is, I want to strike this guy out. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm going to throw my slider. I'm going to throw my, you know, my big breaking ball. Well, now they've seen it, and it's not as much of a surprise second time round. So you can get a lot of hitters out. Maddox and Glavin were real masters at get guys hit the first pitch, get out of there. Now you're in the fourth inning, you've only thrown 30 pitches. Your chances of you going full game is good, or at least deep.
Hayden Grice at the plate right now, and you see the throw over to first. Shawver did a good job last night keeping the Tigers at bay from the left side. McCarthy watching Gallo close. Got to be careful with Grice. You can't just pound fastballs because we know about his raw power. We saw him double into the right center field gap to drive in a run last night. 6'6 freshman from Greer, Blue Ridge High School. Big cut at that. McCarthy snuck it by him.
That was one that he could have drove, just did not catch up with it. That high fastball, just could not get into it.
Gallo, a decent lead out at first base right now. Two outs and two strikes. Clemson already up a run, and McCarthy saw that too.
Yeah, it's a great time to take that chance because then if they throw you out, Grice is back up, lead you off next inning, and if not, you got a chance to push one across again.
Chopper to third, tough spin and a good play. Santiago gets him out, and that's how Cincinnati gets out of the bottom of the second. Tigers up a run, Cincinnati. A great day to be at the ballpark today. Glenn family enjoying the ballpark. Beautiful sunshine here at Clemson. Two innings in the books. Tigers up a run here as Ty Olenchuk goes back to work. And Tanner Holland making his season debut, but Olenchuk's been outstanding the first couple of innings, Marty.
He's doing exactly what you want him to do. Early in the season, you're not going to go a whole game, so save as many pitches as you can, go as long as the coach will let you, throw strikes.
Holland, a native of Manhattan, Kansas. Grad transfer from Kentucky. There's a shot snagged out of the air by Parker.
real fine play as that ball was starting to hook away from him. Looked like it might carry just above him, that he might have jumped a hair soon, but snags it. Outstanding play.
That ball like it was moving away from
him. Yeah, it was hooking, but man, got a little hops in him.
Super defensive play. You see maybe a little wrap on that left wrist. He took a pitch off of that last night, but back in the lineup today. There's a pop straight back and out of play by Jake Murray to start his at-bat with an 0-1 count.
You saw some pretty good swings by Holen and then the first one here. I think they may be thinking he's going to throw a lot of fastballs. And so, you know, you start reading that too. You kind of feel each other out and start thinking, what's he doing? Hasn't thrown a lot of breaking balls. So some better swings this inning.
Square to Bond, and he tries to beat the shift. And Olenchuk's not going to make a throw. That's a great way to start a rally right there, is just lay down a bunt, beat it out.
You couldn't have put it in a better place. I mean, the catcher would have had to sprint and have a tough time changing directions. Pitcher had to go a long way to just try and get there. It was just slow rolling. Probably wouldn't have had a good play anyways, whether he picked it up clean.
Now time called as we got Andrew C., pitching coach, out to chat with Olenchuk. You see the ball strike ratio. He has been all over the strike zone, particularly with that fastball. And just a brief conversation maybe about having somebody on base for the first time in the third inning. Some reminders for the freshman. Now Paul Komastek, the right fielder, native of Knoxville. No shift deployed for him. Middle infield looking for a double play. Boy, that one scraped the knees at 91.
Yeah, he didn't take much of a look at first base. You're going to want to make sure you at least keep an eye on there so he doesn't just get a walking run to second.
Pop foul out of play. He's way ahead, 0-2. Always curious when you got a freshman on the mound, what's he like out of the stretch? How's he holding runners? Pretty quick to the plate on those two pitches.
Yeah, that's a good point. And you know, how's he going to respond to having that first guy make him change his position for the first time? And can he keep his strike zone? Can he keep his mechanics? So far, so good.
No, he did not. Checked and he spit on it. 1-2.
That wasn't a strike, but it had good bite on it. It had good spin and in the right location and just about had him fishing for it.
Decent lead at first from Murray. Just giving Olenchuk something to think about here. It's the first time that Cincinnati's had any runners on base in this series with fewer than two outs. There's a swing and a miss as Olenchuk gets out number two right there.
That pitch was nasty. That's going to be one that this early in the season and their lack of live pitching, they're not going to hit that. That's just great location, good tight spin.
Two strikeouts for Olenchuk, the first time through the order. Back to the top now in Bellini. Bellini struck out three times. Olenchuk almost airmailed Hawkins at first there. Hawkins had to come off the bag. And Bellini, a guy who hit 429 and 28 at-bats last year. Slow start here. Runners moving. French throw down. Not in time.
Pretty good jump on Olenchuk that time. Not a whole lot of chance because it was a breaking ball to get the throw in there in time. So good base running right there.
Right to that corner.
Mm-hmm.
Nicely done there by Murray. And as we just talked about, that's the first runner in scoring position for Cincinnati in 12 innings. doing a dance at second base to try to distract Olenchuk, and there's a foul ball back.
Good swing by Bellini. That pitch was middle of the plate, too, and he's got to be careful there as they're starting to see that fastball now.
We've seen it a lot. He just went to the breaking ball for an out pitch. See what he does here on 0-2. He spikes it in the dirt, and that'll give the runner a chance to advance out to third.
Yeah, he wanted the best breaking ball he's ever thrown in his life that time, and typically what happens is you throw it short. You bite it down and a little too far out even for a catcher to kind of get in front and block it because it hit so far in front. But he's still in good shape. He's got two strikes. Just want to calm down and let it release smooth and easy.
When that happens, is it an overthrow, an overgrip, combination?
Yeah, you squeeze it so tight trying to get such a tight spin that you end up just choking it right in the ground.
There's a little poke to second. Gallo ends the inning. So Olenchuk works out of it, strands the runner at third, and we head to the bottom of the third. The Tigers up 1-0. And Monty Lee in his 6 years as a head coach at Clemson. There you see him. Happy camper after last night with a 5-0 season opening win. And they're in a very similar spot right now where nip and tuck for a while, but they've been able to keep the Bearcats off the scoreboard. And now the bottom of the order. Bryce Teodosio had a really good game yesterday. Native of Simpsonville getting the second start of the year in center field. He was fantastic. A three-hit night. He hits that one high in the air. And now coming on the left fielder. He went back first. Now the shortstop back and makes the play. That was weird. Merritt's first step was back, and he kind of sat there for a second. Bellini ends up making the catch about 150 feet in front of where he was.
Yeah, high sky like this and the wind, you know, you can misjudge it pretty easy.
Now back to the top, Blake Wright. Scored the run off a leadoff double and then a couple of ground outs to advance him over and in. McCarthy starts him off with a strike. Bouncer charging the shortstop. That good infield defense continues, two away. The three pitches and two outs here for McCarthy. That's easier said than done to get quick outs against Dylan Brewer. Ground out victim his first time.
Last time he got quick two outs, he walked a guy. You want to make sure you lefty on lefty that you get ahead and give yourself the best chance to put him away.
Brewer, a 14-13 walk to strikeout ratio last year. And drew three walks yesterday. Tigers walked six times and were hit twice, and he goes around on a good breaking ball. Let's take another look at that.
You can see he's quite out in front of the plate there and broke his hands a little bit.
Danny Everett rung him up at third base. No balls and two strikes. That one bounced.
Early in the season, I remember throwing a lot of short breaking balls.
So Olenchuk knows he's got company there.
Yeah.
That 0-2 pitch. Strike three called. Pretty fastball across the knees, and Brewer knew it. 1-2-3 inning for McCarthy for the first time. Here's another look at strike three called. Beautiful pitch from the southpaw. We're through three. Now you see our umpiring crew. Craig Barron calling balls and strikes behind the plate. Doug Vines out at first base. Randy Watkins manning second and Danny Everett out at third. A veteran group of ACC umpires here this afternoon. Glad to have you with us from inside beautiful Doug Kingsmore Stadium. William Quagamus, Marty Cleary with you. Pop foul, the first pitch from Wyatt Stapp. It was almost immediately a 1-0 lead for Clemson, the bottom of the first. A leadoff double and then a couple of ground outs got the run home. And other than that, Marty, it's been all pitching so far in the first third of the ball game.
Yeah, and I would have expect that at this time of the season. It's just hitters just have not seen enough of it. They'll be behind. The weather will start warming up. They'll see more live pitching. And then you'll start seeing a lot more squaring up of line drives and long home runs probably.
Wyatt Stapp, another one of those preseason all-conference selections. Hit 283 last year, 294 in his freshman season. There's a fly ball to center. Teodosio under it for the first out. Take a look at Olenchuk here now. This is a freshman making his debut. You see the little fist pump.
He's excited about every out, every strike. It's what you live for in college sports, man.
You got to love that youthful exuberance coming right onto a big stage like this.
Yeah, can you imagine? I mean, you know, freshmen don't get to pitch a whole lot. Not everywhere, right? And especially at the programs like this. But he obviously has the stuff, the makeup.
There's a good changeup from him. 1-1 to count. Monty Lee called him a bulldog. Mm-hmm. We told you he was a four-time letter winner in baseball and football at Dutch Fork High School. There you see Coach Lee. And he said that football mentality, that competitive spirit, bleeds over into the way he approaches his craft on the mound.
That's exactly right. Playing other sports gives you a good idea of what they can do. Football players that play basketball, linemen, big guys, move their feet really well. Oh, you can see how that could be important on the football field as well. So.
Good pitch there, right at the knees. Parents, young athletes. What Marty just said, very important. There's a pop up. Let's see if Wright can get there. Wind's blowing it in. Foul ground, and he makes the play. Bit of a roundabout way of getting there, but Wright gets the second out of the inning. Here's another look at that.
You can see that Olenchuk has no idea where it is, at least initially. And even there where the third baseman knows where it's at, that wind, when it gets that high, swirls more, and it changes the direction. So pretty tough plays.
Especially as you said, there's really not a cloud in the sky to help you.
Nowhere to kind of gauge where it is.
That ball is ripped down the right field line, and that is just foul. Boy, Jace Mercer barreled one up. We saw him hit one toward the warning track at Brewer's first time up. He's put a couple of good rips on Olenchuk so far.
Yeah, and he's one that you may start thinking, okay, I've got to try and get my changeup going. I got to try and have my breaking ball here.
Olenchuk's been about 3-1 strikes to balls so far. That one missed up high. Sometimes you can almost be too much in the strike zone. But Olenchuk's done a pretty good job. As you said, he's going to refine that in and out. He's done a pretty good job keeping guys off balance within the zone today as he misses high on that one.
Yeah, there's something to be said for, you know, controlled wildness, right, to where I can throw one kind of all over the place, but know how I can bring it right back in. Hitter never can really settle in. It's hard for him.
If Foul straight back. Mercer hanging around. He knows he missed a good one to hit there. Made a comment last night with Tim Beret here. Mercer likes to chew on his mouthpiece when he's up there, so he kind of pops it out. He bites down on it as he's swinging. Interesting approach. We'll see if it works on the 2-2. He fights it off. Good defensive swing that time on 2-2.
Yeah, those nervous ticks, whatever they are, but usually as it comes in, everything kind of quiets down. You know, bats, legs, all those things can open stances, but when it gets down to the pitch, everything kind of comes together, quiets, and able to throw the head of the bat at it.
Swing and a miss. That was dropped. And you see Olenchuk fired up again. Strikeout number 3 for the freshman. Here's another look at that as he caught Mercer swinging way out in front. And there you see Olenchuk with the reaction off the mound as the Tigers lead by 1. One nothing Clemson through 3.5. We head to the bottom of the 4th briskly here at the ballpark. Elijah Henderson set to lead things off. Tigers with the meat of the order coming up for the 2nd time against McCarthy, who bounces the first pitch to Elijah. Henderson drove in the only run of the game so far with a ground out to the right side of the infield on the first pitch he saw back in the 1st inning. That's a good lollipop breaking ball there into the zone.
Yeah, especially after bouncing something. That's hard to be ready to see that. So you just take it, and that's the right play by the hitter as well.
Middle of the field is open. Shortstop and second baseman pinch a little bit for Henderson. There's a look at your infield alignment. And right on the outside edge, a called strike. Good spot here.
Yeah, McCarthy's definitely settled in. He's got that little tailing fastball. If he puts it in that location, it just keeps looking like it's getting further and further away from you. You don't feel like you should swing at it. Pretty tough pitch.
Henderson loops one. That is going to be caught. What a play by the center fielder, Jake Murray. That was a web gem right there, Marty.
It really was. He froze initially thinking that thing was coming further than it was, and then really had to giddy up and lay outstretched to get a glove on that one. But he froze initially. Now he's coming, and he totally lays out. Just a beautiful. I always get nervous on those. That's a good dislocation of your shoulder position. So good to see he got right up.
James Parker takes a called strike. Here's what he did last night as he took one right off the left hand, kind of wrapped around his body. They attended to him for a couple of minutes. He stayed in the game, and good to see him back in the lineup today, albeit with a little bit of tape and a little extra wrap around that left wrist.
Yeah, there's so many bones in the hand that if it hits it flush, it can fracture very easily. So very fortunate that nothing serious happened on that particular play.
You know, for pitchers, I understand that sometimes you have guys that rotate in at shortstop, but having a shortstop that you can count on to be in there every single day, particularly one as good defensively as Parker, you got to think that's a little bit of a sigh of relief for Monty Lee and for the pitching staff to know that he's still going to be out there.
Well, and you're trying to put together a chemistry, right?
Right.
It's early in the year. You didn't hardly play last year. Haven't had a lot of stuff you can do because of the COVID pandemic. So you want these guys to be able to play and play. So any disruption of that can really set you back. Even though other players are good, it's just you want that chemistry out there. And You get comfortable with each other. You've seen it in the big leagues a lot of a pitcher, superstar pitcher, really likes a certain catcher.
Yep.
And they'll change that particular catcher just for him because there's comfort, there's chemistry, something's going on really magical, and you don't want to mess that up.
Eddie Perez made a lot of money doing that.
Exactly right.
There's a bouncer foul as Parker hangs around. This is more of what we talked about from last night. A lot of quicker at-bats for really for both teams today as both pitchers have been pretty efficient with their pitch counts. But last night, the Tigers were able to get deep into counts an awful lot. Here's a ground ball through the hole, and that is exactly the result you want when you work a pitcher deep into the count.
That's exactly right. He worked him, and then he got one over the plate. That though he didn't scald it, he was able to get good bat on it, square it, put it in the right place.
One out base runner for the Tigers. Second hit of the day for Clemson. Now Jonathan French.
And McCarthy needs to think, I just want to stay right there, get that ball breaking down and in. That next ground ball could be a double play. I don't want to leave it up on somebody like French that can hit it out of the ballpark. So stay relaxed. You had a good pitch.
And French grounded a third his first time up. That same ground ball. Likely a double play as this one skied first base side and foul. And with room, the play's made. Nice play over there by Nicholson right in front of the Clemson dugout. Enemy territory over there, and he's able to focus and make the play.
Looked like it might get into the dugout, but just at the last second, he backed off and made a nice play on it.
French retired. That's a big out with a man at first in a one-run game. Now Briar Hawkins. Hit a ball hard right at the center fielder, Murray, his first time up. Parker Chase back. It was interesting. Yesterday, Tigers didn't really get anything going on the bases for the first five innings. They got time behind the plate. Shauver. Well, I guess the first four innings, they didn't get much going. Then in the fifth, they had a stolen base and then added one or two more throughout in terms of just being able to advance. When you have a lefty on the mound, it changes the way that you look to run. Jared Broughton, the first base coach, is somewhat of a savant. That sort of side of the game. 0-1 to Hawkins. Now McCarthy's way ahead, 0-2. He can focus on the batter now.
Shaking his arm a little. I don't know if it's bothering him or that's just his nervous tick. Looks to be throwing real well, so.
Here's Jared Broughton, the volunteer assistant for this Clemson team. That ball's shot. Look out. I think bent around the netting and carom like a pinball.
Yeah, that was cheek high for people standing on the deck there too. And fortunately got past everybody's facial bones.
Oh, and now they've got him picked off. Throw down to second and Parker is out. McCarthy gets the easy out as Parker was running on first movement. And that's how the inning will end. Another look at it as McCarthy got Parker in no man's land. And the Bearcats will head to the plate, trailing by one in the fifth. Well, four innings in the books. It's been a pitcher's duel. Ty Olenchuk certainly set the tone. The Tigers so far the only one to scratch. And Marty, They were able to do it playing a little small ball after Blake Wright led off the bottom of the first with a double.
Yeah, and then you get the get him over swing, and then eventually get him in swing. That not a big hit, but just enough to get a run.
And that's all we've got so far, as both Ty Olenchuk and Dean McCarthy have taken turns dealing. Only three hits so far combined for the two teams. Olenchuk's given up just one hit with no walks and three strikeouts so far, and only 47 pitches through four innings, and he gets a swing and a miss on a pitch in the dirt by Eric Santiago to start out the top of the fifth.
That's where the guy's thinking, all fastballs, all fastball. Boop. Not fastball. Of course, it was about like this last night before things got all broken up for the Clemson's favor. And when you switch pitchers, so it'd be interesting to see how that transition goes, because they're definitely, I wouldn't assume they're going to throw the whole game. So when that transition occurs is when you peek again to see where are those guys at.
There's a shot to center field. That's going to drop in for a hit. And for the first time in this series, the Bearcats have got the leadoff man aboard. Good swing by Santiago here.
Yeah, a real good piece of hitting, and looked bad on the first, but he got his fastball and he was ready for it. And you could tell that's what he was looking for by the way he swung the first time. And he's a freshman. It won't be long before he starts backing up, breaking ball, because he's aware of what hitters are looking for.
Now Merritt. Santiago playing around at first base. That ball's hit in the air. It's tailing, and it's going to go out of play. I think Santiago saw what you talked about the first time there was a base runner out there at first. That Olenchuk, I think he's aware, but he's not really looking over there, and so Santiago's kind of trying to mess with him a little bit out at first base.
Yeah, he acted like he was going to go and then just kind of stopped in his tracks.
Rocket foul just wide of first base. That would have been a problem down in the corner, as we might have seen Santiago's wheels on that one.
Yeah, had that been inside the line, that would have been trouble.
No balls and two strikes.
Of course, with the guy on holding, it could have been a double play.
That's true.
You know, because he's already right there.
I love that pitcher's perspective. Gotta love that.
Well, I'm always hoping for the double play.
Good sized lead for Santiago, and that a defensive swing by Merritt to hang around.
Good time for that sharp breaking ball. Maybe get a strike him out, throw him out situation.
And got him. Chase him back, and boy, that was close. You wondered if that strategy from Santiago might bite him in the rear at some point, and it almost did right there.
He was trying to get him to time. He's been going, look, lift, look, lift, and he kept thinking, if he lifts, I'm gone, but he never did. He is keeping an eye, and sometimes you can't notice that because it's out of the corner of his eye.
Oh, and then right in the back, he hits Griffin Merritt.
And that's the difficult part of being young in a huge environment. He was trying to steal. He knew it. Almost had him picked. Now I'm going to do that real quick one and have him off step and get a double play, and didn't get your mechanics in line. And so it was off a little bit, and he ran it up in the end, and now he's got a tough situation.
So you would say that, I mean, we just talked about how it almost backfired on Santiago, but you would say that the playing games at first base, you get the man behind you on board by getting in the pitcher's head, now it's worth it.
Yeah, well, it I mean, it's always after the fact you know whether it's worth it or not, right?
Right.
But you're trying to do something to disrupt him because he is so comfortable right now. So you're trying to make anything happen.
Breaking ball in the dirt, throw down to third, and the runner's out. Jonathan French wheeled around and made the throw, and that'll back your pitcher. Let's take another look at that.
So that's really bad base running in the fact that you've got to know it's by the catcher significantly to give up an out at third base. And it just not get away. Now, was it a tremendous play? Yes. But was the ball far from the catcher? No. So they'll talk about that one.
Now let's see what Holand can do. He had a line drive right at the shortstop, Parker, that he had to climb the ladder to snag his first time up. And now the count's even a ball and a strike.
And the other thing is you got a pitcher now who's nervous. Getting an out there, you saw the next pitch, how calm he had now. It just brought everything back. Now I'm back in control.
There's another breaking ball that missed the barrel, 1-2.
So that one play changed the whole perspective on the pitcher and where you are now as an offense trying to score.
Olenchuk taking a deep breath toward the back of the mound. Holand, a senior, wasn't in the lineup yesterday, but again, barreled one up earlier. A little bit in, 2-2.
Didn't get the good bite that he had gotten on the two previous ones, and had he done that, he would have caught him looking.
Big pitch here. In a one-run game.
Looked like Olenchuk was doing something with second baseman. I'm just wondering if they're going to try and come behind him.
In the dirt. Count's full. It's the first full count we've seen Olenchuk get into today.
Yeah, and just think if it was still first and second, nobody out, right? And
yes, sir.
That's why that first out at third has to be almost, you just can't make it. You got to make sure that you've got it. He can afford to try and make the perfect pitch right here with it open at first.
Got to think there's some pressure here both ways too, because everybody in that Cincinnati dugout knows they've yet to score in this series. They've got a great opportunity here to tie it with one swing of the bat. Holand tried to rip it somewhere and fouled it straight back.
Pretty good cut on that, and the hitter was really looking fastball, and if it wasn't in that good of a location, he probably would have made real good contact on it. But that ball was just an inch probably off the plate.
Tigers do have some stirring in the bullpen right now. Evan Estridge. He looks to be just about ready to go as soon as Monty Lee wants to use him. Fly ball to Brewer out and right, and he makes the catch and makes sure nobody's running today.
I was thinking in my head, good time to get inside if you have good control, and he kind of did that. Up and in a little bit, jammed him, got a weak fly ball, unable to advance to third, and gonna calm him down, I think. I don't think this is a change thought. I think this is, okay, you battle back, you got two outs now. Now's when you want to make your best pitches.
And another reason for the conversation may be he's about to face Murray, who is one of the three left-hand batters, and he's the one that's got the hit so far today. The only hit before Santiago, and they are going to lift him. Fantastic debut for Ty Olenchuk. He'll give way to a veteran. We'll find out more about him after this. And there's a look at Evan Estridge, a junior from Chapin, South Carolina. You see the measurement, 6'3", 215. A right-hander that Monty Lee and Andrew C. and the Clemson staff feel good about being a bridge guy for him from the starter to the back end of the bullpen, and excited to see him in a Clemson uniform here today.
I wasn't sure that they would do that move right then, but it doesn't necessarily surprise me either. With a freshman on the mound, you want to leave him with as much confidence and good taste about his first outing as you can. Bring in somebody with some experience, somebody that's been here before. This hitter now has not seen him, so it's all brand new. It's not like he's had seen Olenchuk in the past. So a lot of good things to happen from making the change. I know as a pitcher, you always want to get five. That's who you are. And so I know Olenchuk felt that coming out, but his manager, his coach is doing the best thing for him and really looking out for him.
And you see him, he was fired up quite a bit on the mound, and his teammates and the coaching staff welcomed him back in with open arms there as he gave his team a chance to win. How tough is that from a coaching standpoint? Because you know that guy wants to go five, and you want him, because he's pitched so well, to get that statistical win or at least be eligible for it. But you also know that you don't want to put a freshman in a spot to maybe lose that opportunity.
Yeah, you don't want an L on him first time out. You know, if it was 3-0, you give him a chance to get through that inning probably. But, you know, it's early in the year. You want other guys. You want to see what they do in these conditions too. So, you know, good job by Monty Lee.
And Estridge turns and bluffs a throw to second against Murray, who singled on a bunt his first time up. Did a good job trying to get something started for the Bearcats. He was stranded at second base back in the third. Way outside from Estridge, ball one. He's a transfer from Newberry College, who only appeared in a couple of games last year, but Monty Lee says he made some strides in the fall. The velocity ticked up. And he's one of those guys, again, in the middle of the ball game that they feel good about going to here. Off speed there to get him way out in front.
So one of his best pitches is that changeup, which is nothing that they've seen so far. So really difficult on left-handed hitters, and probably one of the main reasons, too, why Coach Lee decided to go with this particular pitcher.
1-1 to Murray, swinging a miss out in front again.
So he showed him no fastball. He's not showing him at all. Everything's going to have a wrinkle on it, and you're going to have to earn it as a hitter. Again, down and away, and they've just not seen that, so it's hard for them to lay off of it.
Runner leads a second, the potential tying run, and another changeup. That one tailed off the plate.
And you can kind of tell that that's what they expected him to be coming in and throwing a lot of changeups or whatever. Look where they're playing him. They've got shortstop over second base side. So they expect him to pull it.
That's right. 2-2. Foul back. There he came with a fastball, and Murray was late.
Yeah, and probably the worst location you could have in that defense, right?
Yes.
A fastball up and away, because you're going to be late and hit it that way, and now you've got that whole open spot. So you wanted to probably try and get that inside, I bet, is what he was hoping to do on that.
That ball's ripped to right field. Long run for Brewer. He'll make the catch and retire the side. So Evan Estridge gets the Tigers through the fifth. We're halfway home with Clemson sporting a 1-0 lead. Well, now a chance to look at what's coming down the pike in the ACC. If everything goes according to plan, every conference a little bit different, Marty, but 50 games, they're going to take a couple of weekends off, but they're adding a couple to the conference schedule so that the vast majority of games the teams will play will be against their peers in the league.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to have to try and figure out how do you schedule stuff in this pandemic. All it takes is one bad thing and you're in a mess. And so hats off to them. We need it. We need sports. We need some avenues to get out there and enjoy. So hopefully we get all 50.
Amen to that. Tigers up 1-0 here. McCarthy back out for his fifth inning of work. He's relatively the same spot in terms of pitch count that Olenchuk was to start the fifth. And there's a line drive to left center. Let's see if Hawkins is looking to push. He will round and stop at first base. That's a leadoff single there for the Tigers' number six hitter. Another look at that one.
Yeah, right down the middle and a good piece of hitting. Just not good location right there on that one. So, you know, but this is the time of the game where, you know, you're thinking maybe we can get somebody up, maybe get somebody ready. So my guess is they'll probably be working that. And it can happen so fast when you fatigue early in a season. You're not used to throwing a lot of pitches or a lot of innings, even though it may not be a number count.
Pierce Gallo takes, and oh, he didn't take. He went around on the first pitch, strike one. We'll see if he did. Yeah, he did.
Umpires have done a good game so far today.
As expected. That one's taken low. Gallo took a four-pitch walk, so he's probably up there looking to swing this time. Bearcats, as of yet, not getting anybody up, but as you said, Marty, it's really only a matter of time, particularly if Clemson can get another base runner or, oh boy, hopped over the glove, and now we've got a fielder's interference, I believe, as our second base umpire, Randy Watkins, pointing at the second baseman. And Monty Lee, I think, is going to ask about that. Let's see how they rule this. First of all, that was a difficult high hop for the second baseman, Mercer. But then Mercer was sort of in the baseline, and Hawkins plowed into him. And now Monty Lee's going to ask maybe for an extra base here. And I'm not sure what's going to come out of this. It looks like Randy Watkins is ready to give him second base, but not sure he's going to give him third right now as there's a conversation going on.
Yeah, I'm not exactly sure why you wouldn't. I mean, it's not as if the base runner hit him and took him out of a play. If he was in the base path, it's generally automatic.
Yeah, Monty, do you see? I mean, he's telling exactly what he saw to Randy Watkins, and there's a mutual respect going on right now in the conversation, and we know in baseball that can flip in a moment, so we'll keep you right here just in case. As you said, the umpiring crew's done a really good job, and I think they're going to come together here. They are going to bring everybody together. Here's a look at it. Now, you see Mercer tried to get out of the way and actually got further into the way there. Another look at this. He jumps back into him.
He's definitely dead in the base path. I mean, it's dead in the base path. So I don't know if he just called it was dead ball. I don't know. I think that's obstruction. But
I guess one way of seeing that play is because he hadn't gotten to second base yet.
He gets that next base.
Maybe he gets that next one, and maybe he doesn't go to third, because you could also make the argument here. And they're going to go look at this. You can make the argument, I think Monty Lee would, that his intent was to round third. But you could also say that he didn't really round third. He more stumbled around third and stopped. So it'll be very interesting to see this. Now, they're going to talk to Monty Lee. I thought they were going to run in and review this, but you've got home plate umpire Craig Barron and second base umpire Randy Watkins out there right now, I believe, talking to Monty Lee.
This is difficult on McCarthy, too. It's sunny, but it's cool. And having to stop like that and break.
Here's another look at it. And again, there's the obstruction.
See, I just think that is, because had he not backed up, he goes around him and on to third. It wasn't a purposeful backup to hit him, but it did stop his momentum from getting around and going on to third base. So, I don't know.
I tend to agree with that interpretation of things. Nevertheless, we play on. First and second, nobody out. Either way, Clemson's got something brewing here in the bottom of the fifth, up a run. And now McCarthy, look, he kind of stumbled off the rubber there, but spun around a second. Ruling is a single there, and that was a tough hop, so I'm actually glad. I thought Initially, that might have been an error, but that thing jumped right up over the top of the glove of the second baseman, Mercer. Caden Grice takes a strike, 0-1.
Yeah, I think he was hoping he could catch that short hop and didn't get there in time, and it was a big hop. And it was high up in his jaw area by the time it got by him.
Grice, you see him, big 6'6". One of two Greer natives on the Clemson roster. And I misspoke earlier, said he was from Blue Ridge. Elijah Henderson's from Blue Ridge. He's from Riverside, and I know that offended quite a few people from Greer. Apologies. I'm going to keep those guys straight. It's a big spot for McCarthy as there is now some action going in the Bearcats' bullpen, and he just missed the outside corner on Grice, 1-1.
Catcher wanted it bad. He turned around and just, you sure you got that one right?
Gallo and Hawkins aboard with back-to-back singles here to start the fifth for the Tigers. Grice, capable of damage, and you see McCarthy, he's trying not to throw a fat fastball in there to him.
But fast finding himself behind the eight ball with nobody out and two guys on already. And he's going to have to challenge here.
Dino, once you're out there, Kane, that baseball.
Oh, out in front there. Good pitch.
And that was a challenge with a good breaking ball. He just made sure it was in the zone. And he was looking dead red fastball.
Oh, a 2-2 count.
Now shorten up a little bit. Try and put it in play. If you get it down center and you get a good piece of it, great.
What's your out there?
McCarthy's delivery just missed. Wow.
Pretty close right there.
Trackman says it missed. Real time, I wasn't sure. Boy, that's
a little low.
Close.
He's got some tall knees, so we'll give him the benefit of the doubt there.
Tigers up a run. Big pitch here. Ball four. Good at bat by Grice. He let that 2-2 pitch go and then took an easy one. And now the Bearcats bullpen's doing double time. It looks like 19, Drake Baccio, left-hander, is in the bullpen, but he's... And the catcher's not even squatted down yet, so this is going to be a calm-down tactic for sure, but also you know in that third-base dugout, you got to buy some time. As there you see Baccio, he's not even throwing really off the mound yet in his routine. So it's going to be another batter or two at best before he's able to come into the game, and that's why you see a pitching coach visit to the mound right now to have a little chat. You see the balls and strikes from McCarthy. He really has pitched well. And you got to say, Marty, as a pitcher, when you get the leadoff man aboard and then you induce a ground ball at a fielder, I know it took a bad hop and it wasn't ruled an error. That's got to sink your confidence at least a little bit.
Yeah, you feel like you made the pitch, right? Felt like you made the double play pitch, actually, and could have had that swipe clean. When I first saw it hit, I thought that, and I thought he was going to make the short hop quick double play, but... didn't get in there close enough, and it got a real bad hop on him, and now you're in a lot world of hurt.
You just saw a second ago, a right-hander has joined the fray in that bullpen, Jalen Wade, a junior. So double barrel action now in the Cincinnati bullpen, and there's Bryce Teodosio with a line drive, and that's going to fall in for a base hit and score the second run of the game. Briar Hawkins crosses the plate, and Teodosio continues to swing a hot bat. That's four hits in two games for Bryce.
This is kind of the this is kind of the same time when the wheels came off last night, as you got fifth inning type situation, and he just did it. Hit a bullet up the middle. Look at him, how excited he is. He's pumped.
Guy who really has made hay in this Clemson program for his defensive acumen. But if he can swing the bat, it's a no-brainer to put him in the lineup every day. There's no doubt. Now Blake Wright, who scored the first run of the game, he's up again with the bases loaded and nobody out. Right there, the center fielder did a good job of keeping everybody at bay by kind of looking like he had a chance maybe to catch it. Keep the Tigers to one run instead of potentially two there on a line drive. Foul back.
Bearcats might want to rethink, wish they could go back a little bit and have somebody already ready. You know, I mean, first time out, not a lot of pitches thrown, but again, you've not done pitch inning after inning after inning in a long time.
Now time called, and really this thing unraveled quickly.
Yes.
He's only thrown 60 pitches. It's not like this been anywhere he's labored for 20 or 25 pitches.
Right. Plus you had the delay on the discussion on the interference. You had the delay coming out. A lot of negatives happening on the pitcher in this inning.
And you pointed out both of those things. Some tough breaks for McCarthy, who really has thrown well in this game today. Bouncer to third, and that's going to be foul.
Yeah, and I think Cincinnati can take a lot of good things out of that, no matter what happens here today. Okay, so far, both of our starting pitchers did really good. They presented themselves well. They threw a lot of strikes. They mixed in pitches, handled tough situations. So they got a lot to look forward to still with what they've seen.
Break even pitch. Missed badly. There's nowhere to put right. You got to come with a strike here. Got a veteran pitcher and a freshman batter. I think McCarthy, at least mentally, has got the edge, but Wright's got an advanced approach. Way upstairs. That'll get another run in as Blake Wright was able to watch his way to an RBI.
Yeah, and that's how quickly it can happen to you. Just looks so benign initially in the inning, and next thing you know, you're in a mess. And that's why that third out on the inning before, making the first out at third, when you had Olenchuk a little bit on the ropes, could have turned in this same type of scenario, and you don't want to make a first out on third base.
They may leave him in to face the lefty Brewer here. There's a strike going one. Keep kind of peeking over there just to see what's happening. It looks like Bacho, the lefty, has sat down, so he's either ready or they're not going to put him in. Right-hander, Wade still throwing.
Body mechanics right now are really starting to fade on McCarthy. You're seeing him kind of swing off the center on his release point, and that's kind of a sign of fatigue.
Ripped to right. That's going to get the run in regardless. Neither of the other runners advance, but Brewer gets himself an RBI as Grice will cross for the third run of the inning. Good rip by Brewer here, and you see the tag from third.
Yeah, they weren't going to throw him out. They just went ahead and got it in. Trying to defuse the situation a little bit.
And that'll do it for McCarthy, as we see out of the dugout emerge his head coach, Scott Guggins. Bearcats will head to the bullpen. It'll be the right-hander, Wade, a junior. And again, as you talked about, Marty, a tough fifth inning for McCarthy that really poorly punctuated what was a good outing for him, and he'll leave two guys on base. We'll tell you about the new arm for the Bearcats when we come back in a moment. There you see right-hander Jalen Wade out of Westchester, Pennsylvania. Big tall presence on the mound, 6'4", 215. The bullpen for Cincinnati was relatively right-handed last night, as we saw a couple of right-handers outside of the lefty starter. And here again, Bearcats have chosen to go with the righty Wade, who is a bit of a veteran. Again, a lot of the veterans on this team are transfers, so one degree or another, either grad transfer or just a straight transfer. But we'll see what he's got for the Tigers here. And he comes out inheriting a couple of runners at first and second. It always could be worse, but only one out. And the out was a productive one just now on a sac fly to right. It's a tough situation to bring a guy in for the first time all year with this team, all of a sudden down four runs.
Yeah, and coming out of the bullpen, it's crucial that you have a couple pitches, because they're thinking you're coming in with only fastball, you got to throw a strike, et cetera. You've got to be able to throw a strike with a secondary pitch here that keeps them off balance, and just have to have control of that to be very successful.
Here's Elijah Henderson. RBI ground out, his more productive at bat of the two. McCarthy, again, already four runs credited to him. And these two base runners are his as well. Good breaking ball there from Wade, 74 on the gun.
Yeah, hitting with that was big because he had already gotten behind. Hitters are starting to get really comfortable. So hitting with that breaking ball now changes the whole scenario, and you have to be a little bit more cautious of what you're looking for.
Check swing. That's going to trickle foul.
Came right back with another one. And obviously the hitter was off balance and did not get a good cut at that. Really good 12-6 type spin.
Wait a chance to punch a guy out here. 2019, he threw just one inning. And had a season-ending injury, did not pitch a year ago, so this is his first action in quite a while. Way up high, 2-2. Okay.
Fastball's about 87, 88, looks like. But a real big breaking ball, and that's throwing that high fastball is great with a 12-6 breaking ball because it starts looking like fastball.
Did it right there. Ground ball to third. He's out at third. The throw to first in time. What a play by Santiago at third. Quickly puts the foot on the bag on the high chopper. And then throws across for the 5-3 double play. That's a good way to back your pitcher as we're through five. The Tigers able to scratch three. As Cincinnati comes back to the dish when we come back. 4-0 Clemson the lead through five innings of play here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium. The grounds crew looking to beautify the infield for the final four innings of play. Glad to have you here this afternoon. William Quackenbush, Marty Clary with you. All Clemson on the scoreboard, really. It was all pitching until things kind of unraveled there in the fifth. And you think it was sort of a collective effort there for Cincinnati as we're about to see them get out of it, but they kind of got themselves into a jam.
A lot of different things were happening. He's now in his fifth inning pitching. Hadn't thrown a lot of pitches. Now you see the big double play right there, but hadn't thrown a lot of pitches, but five innings. Hadn't done that in a long time. Then you had to delay for a call. Then you had to delay for the talking. And, kind of some misplays on some of the ground ball or maybe something like that. So unfortunate for them, but Tigers took great advantage of that as they pushed runs across.
On that last play, Santiago was able to make the quick turn at third. You kind of made an observation Teodosio, probably they're going to talk to him in the dugout about sliding into that bag to make that a little bit closer play.
Yeah, because if you don't, you're going to hit and run past it going full speed. So you just go ahead and give yourself up and do a pop-up type slide. You know, hit it and come up. That doesn't allow them to do the tag out, force out at third. It forces them either to just get the play at first and keep your inning alive. So.
Now Clemson with a 4-0 lead. Evan Estridge in a much different spot than he was at the tying run at second base when he came in with two outs in the fifth. He'll face 9-1 and 2 in the order in the top half of the sixth here.
And did a great job coming in throwing that secondary pitch. I mean, he really had him off balance, and that was the advantage to the pitcher then.
This ball is hammered to center field. Teodosio racing back into the shadows at the wall. It is gone. Teodosio, to the last moment, thought he had a chance at it, but it's the nine-hitter, Paul Komestek, with a first run of the season for the Bearcats.
Yeah, he hit that one well. Teodosio was screaming to get back there, and he just had his body just a little off and did not get the height I think he would have liked to have gotten on that, but almost still pulled it in. You see him right there. He turns the opposite way, and it pops out of his glove. He actually had it.
And boy, that was tough to tell live. It did look like it hit in his glove.
Here's where he could have, if he could have just saw it a little bit better, he had to turn as he jumped. If he could have touched the wall and gotten over, he would have pulled it back.
Good break for the Bearcats there, and they've earned that. There's a fly ball from Bellini to right. Brewer tracks it and makes the play.
And as a coach, I can live with a single one-run home run. Attacking the strike zone.
In fact, that's really a byproduct of exactly what you said, attacking the zone. You'd rather have that than a leadoff walk in that instance.
I think so. I think early in the season, you're expecting, you know, hitters to be a little bit behind. You know, you want your defense to be alert. So stay on track, throw strikes, play defense, play the odds on that.
Stab, he took a heck of a cut and missed, 0-1.
That's the equalizer right there of people who get real excited about the fastball. He's come back with a changeup. And you'll probably see him mix that up a good bit now, especially on lefties.
Tried to come with it again, and Stab didn't chase this time. Infield just slightly around a pull. Here's a tapper right to him. Stab spiked the bat that time. Rolled right over it to Estridge, who fields his position well.
He keeps wanting to throw it a little bit harder, and he keeps taking a little bit off, and he just couldn't wait. Tipped it right back to the pitcher.
Now Ryan Nicholson. Hit one hard to center field his first time up. Packs some pop into the bat. Pitch missed downstairs. You look at Cincinnati last year, an offensive profile that was very similar to the one that Clemson was putting together. Leader on this team in home runs. And the two leaders, Merritt and Komestek, had three apiece. A lot of guys had one, and then a few had none. This is a team that was very good at station to station, stealing bases, productive outs, that kind of a strategy. Nicholson hit 400, didn't hit a home run last year.
I like the stature of them, the way they present themselves at the plate, on the field. I think they got a lot of of good things happening there. I think they'll do well when they get to play in their conference and things like that.
Ball four inside. Picked to finish toward the middle of the pack in the AAC, but as we mentioned at the start of things here today, this is the defending conference champions and a program that's building quite a bit of momentum here in the fourth season for Scott Guggins. Four-pitch walk issued to Nicholson there, and that puts the tying run on deck for Cincinnati as Mercer, who's had two good at-bats. He's hit the ball hard a bunch. He struck out his last time up because a couple of those hard-hit balls were foul. All of a sudden, Estridge having a hard time. He's throwing nothing but strikes, and now six straight have missed the zone for him.
Yeah, and you don't – two-out walks tend to turn into nightmares. And so you want to get on top of this, get in there, get a strike, get out of there. Get off the field and let the offense get back to work.
Checks the runner. Pretty conservative lead out there. There's a high strike.
That fastball is about 90, and so working off his changeup's about 83. So a good change of speed on him.
Big cut and a miss there. 2-2. That one's worth another look.
Another change, and just it's hard to lay off of it when your arm speed looks exactly the same on both pitches.
Two-two pitch, swing and a miss. Came back with another changeup and got the strikeout. And a run across, a runner stranded, but a punch out for Estridge to end the top of the sixth with the Tigers up 4-1. Clemson with a 4-1 lead in the bottom of the sixth. They will face a new pitcher as the Bearcats have gone to the bullpen again. Going with lefty Drake Baccio. We told you he warmed up, sat down, and now he has entered the game. 6'4", 215. He started four times a year ago and struck out 24 guys in 16 2/3 innings. And they've gone lefty, lefty, lefty in their rotation. This is another guy that very easily could have been a rotation arm for the Bearcats.
Yeah, and who knows how it'll turn out. I mean, you start off season with certain thoughts, and as players develop and as they perform, you make changes or keep it. So, you know, Mon Lee's doing the same thing. He decided, I'm going to start with my freshman guys on the weekend, but he's got other guys in there that's filling in behind him. He's watching them and seeing who's going to be the next one available. If you get an injury, just sick, all kinds of crazy things can happen. So you want to develop as much talent as you can as you're getting along, especially early in the season.
You made a comment early about effectively wild. How about first pitch goes to the backstop?
Yeah, and you're throwing low 90s, so at some point you got to throw a strikeout.
You got to have the effectively part, right? You got to add it in there. 2-0 pitch from Baccio, and it's 3-0, and he is all over the place right now. And I would imagine that, I think you see James Parker, I'd imagine he's got his bat on the shoulder once and maybe twice here.
Yeah, at least once for sure, I think. And
three-oh pitch, and he hits the plate for a strike.
Yeah, and he's got a live arm. That's 94 right there when he brings it down in the zone.
Parker, a big rip at another fastball, and he keeps cranking it up.
Yeah, now he's up 95. So, obviously, he's got a live arm, and who knows? He may turn into one of your starters as you get along, weekend guys.
Payoff pitch way up and outside. Parker works a walk. He's aboard for the second time today.
I don't know what his history is on walks or control or anything like that, but that's one of the things that can determine what you're better gonna perform better at, whether starter, you can be a little more wild. You got a little more time, a little opportunity there. Come out of the pen, you got to throw strikes because you're usually coming in with guys already on base, so you can't make many errors there.
Now last year, 16 and two-thirds innings. We told you the 24 strikeouts. He did walk 16 guys, to your point. So that may be the big issue, maybe keeping him out of the rotation as he deals low to French, ball one. Another lefty to hold runners. Pops straight up. That's going to fade into the outfield grass. Who's got it? Oh, dropped. And that's going to be a force out at second base as that ball was dropped by the second baseman, Mercer. And there again, you talked about the sky here has been so difficult. It really, the way guys have struggled with the ball in the air, it's a wonder we made it this long without a play that looks like this.
Absolutely. Everyone's really struggled. They've generally come up with it. But that one, he just couldn't find out where it was until it was too late. And if you've never tried to catch a ball in a blue sky like that, no clouds, it's somewhat scary because it disappears.
We've seen a number of times guys shrug their shoulders as the ball's in the air, can't find it in the air. As you saw right there, you find it and lose it in a heartbeat. Mm-hmm. Brian Hawkins, he takes a strike. Hawkins 1-for-2. He scored a run back in the fifth. He led the inning off with a single to left center field. Pretty good pitch there from Baccio.
You see his mechanics, though. He's really a lot of effort in his mechanics. You see a lot of, to me, what is ballistic movements rather than smooth and controlled like we talked about with Olenchuk earlier, who was throwing 94, 95 type situation. He really snaps his body and head.
Speaking of snap, there's a snap throw over to first, but runner French gets back. Some people might call that herky-jerky, you're talking about ballistic movement there, right?
Yeah, he could do him a favor by quieting his head and front shoulder down just a little bit, because right there is all you need. He's throwing 92 right there and had good location. But you see how he swings almost out of control at the end because he's trying to get so much velocity.
Hawkins awaits a 2-2 pitch here. Our first one out, his team up three. Fouled it away. That time, I'm not sure Hawkins was looking fastball there because that was a 92-mile-an-hour fastball, basically grooved, and he kind of took a defensive swing at it.
Yep.
Baccio looking for an out pitch. Can he find it? Oh, he found the line drive right in his glove and doubles off the runner at first. How do you do?
Wow, what a play. That's some quick cat-like reactions right there.
Shot to the pitcher, maybe a shot in the arm for the Bearcats. They'll come to bat down 4-1 as we enter the seventh in just a moment. Clemson 4, Cincinnati 1 after six innings. And the Tigers had a chance to put a couple of more on the board. They got a couple of guys on base. The line drive, double play, 1-3. Got Cincinnati out of the inning right now. And now the Bearcats looking to use that for a little fuel here offensively against Estridge. Eric Santiago singled to lead off the fifth. A little low there, ball one.
That looked good to me. Of course, I'm a pitcher.
You don't mind that expansive side. It's slightly expansive. Well, there's a good change up. Tigers getting another arm warming up. Rasesh Pandya. Out there warming. That ball's ripped to left. That thing's going to find the corner. And rounding first and heading for second is Santiago. And he's seeing the ball real well right now.
Well, that pitch is up high enough to where you can see it real well. Way too high. And with not enough velocity on his shoulder to be able to get it by him. So he had a good cut at that and drove it into the corner.
Now Griffin Merritt, he was hit by a pitch back in the fifth. We're getting down toward the end of the first time through the order for Estridge. Tanner Holland in the hole is the last guy that hadn't seen him. You wonder if that may be the thing that causes Monty Lee to reach into the back end of his bullpen. It's scooped back there by French on a ball in the dirt. So far today, Cincinnati 0 for 3 with runners in scoring position. They are 0 for 5 with runners on base. And that's after a game last night where they didn't get a runner to scoring position and were 0 for 3 with runners on base. Throw back to second.
Not real thrilled about that. You up three runs. Let's get the out, you know. Really concentrate on hitters. Make sure you're down in the zone.
It's a similar tactic Santiago's using here that he used a couple innings ago when he was on with Olenchuk, as we see this last pitch here. Big swing and a miss. Santiago trying to get Nestridge's head, and you talked about with a three-run lead, he's probably not going anywhere.
Just make him stop and then deliver the ball.
That ball's ripped, and that is going to get the run home and probably be extra bases. And an easy stand-up double and an RBI for Griffin Merritt, and all of a sudden, here come the Bearcats. It's 4-2.
Yeah, the one danger of changeups is if you throw it in a bad location, it's pretty hittable. And so both of those, he let it get up in the middle of the plate and about chest high. And pretty easy to handle right there as you see him drive it down in the corner. Easily scores the runner.
Yeah, Santiago crosses, and now Andrew C. out to have a chat with right-hander Estridge. You see the meeting of the minds at the mound. And I believe they are going to go to the bullpen here.
Yeah, it's hard to tell with Mass and Coach, but I think that's Lee.
It might be Monty Lee out there.
It's hard to tell.
It is really difficult. And, yeah, I guess C's bringing the hook. Yes, indeed. So they're going to go to the bullpen. Rasesh Pandya making his Clemson debut as Estridge walks off the mound. Tying runs coming to the plate. We'll tell you about Pandya when we come back to Doug Kingsmore. Back here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium, tying run coming to the plate for Cincinnati. They're going to face a new pitcher, Rasesh Pandya. He's a junior from Greenville. He started his collegiate career at Wofford College and is making his Clemson debut right here in a tough spot out of the bullpen.
Well, he's got some experience, so it's, you know, it's a good guy to kind of go to. Looks like he's got really good mechanics, so you expect him to be around the plate. And see him mixing in his breaking balls now in his warm-up, so bring several pitches with him. So Clemson needs somebody to get an out here. And obviously, Cincinnati's looking to build off of what they've already done this inning.
And Pandya, you look at his three seasons at Wofford, 37 relief appearances, a 6-2 record, a 2.59 ERA, Five saves to his credit, so it's a guy with back into the bullpen experience. 55 and two-thirds innings pitched, 14 walks and 64 strikeouts. Out of Malden High School. So a guy that's been awfully effective with a sub-3 ERA, and now it's a whole other ball game. I believe this with all my heart, that the key to a bullpen is stranding inherited runners.
Yes.
Develops trust, and it builds confidence with everybody in the dugout. Off speed, the first pitch. That's not even fair.
Yeah, that one was fantastic. I mean, that's what I'm saying. If you can come in and have to throw like that, they're looking fastball. I'm going to make this pay right off the bat, and now you're out in front of it, and you're down one strike.
Tanner Holen, the catcher. Line out and a fly out. He'll peel and throw back to second. Bottom third of the order has hit the ball hard. Holen's hit it hard twice. Murray hit the ball back into right field his first time up. The eight hitter on deck, and then Comastek hit the home run. There's a breaking ball, 0-2.
That has tight spin on it, so that's hard to pick up. Really, really tough on a hitter, especially after you've been seeing a lot of other types of pitches.
Saw the changeup and a curveball. Another curveball, and that one grounded to short. Parker, a low throw, a good scoop over there at first base by Hawkins.
Boy, I could see that coming, the way he clutched it twice in his glove and then had to really rush it to get it on time. So nice play by the first baseman there.
Now Pandia gets to take a deep breath and deal with Murray. And as we talked about, this is a guy, he had a bunt single and then ripped a ball to right field his last time up. Up underneath the breaking ball that time. Talk about changing speeds. He hadn't really changed speeds, but he's changed pitches from the changeup to the curveball. And that really is enough to keep hitters off balance for a little while.
Absolutely, because it starts like fastball, then it starts breaking in on you, changes planes.
Ripped to left and caught by Henderson, and a quick second out for Pandia here in the top of the seventh. Now Comastek, saw him go big fly out of here his last time up to center field. Just out of the reach of Bryce Teodosio. Bounced off his glove. French again has to go down to block one. Finally got the big hit with runner in scoring position with the RBI double by Merritt. The first one in 2 days for the Bearcats. And since then, Pandy has gotten back-to-back outs here. Big cut and a miss.
And I would expect him to just back up breaking balls on this right-handed versus right-handed situation with a base open and two outs. Not let him see anything straight.
Strike two. Right in there on the corner.
That's a backup slider that you get away with because it looks like it's coming at you initially, but you don't want to stay there because that can be long fly ball. And so he wants to get this one away from him in a little bit.
Swing and a miss. And Pandia comes in out of the bullpen and shows why the Tigers want him in a high leverage role. Bearcats get a run, but they're still down two. It's stretch time at Doug Kingsmore. To the bottom of the seventh we go. William Quagamush, Marty Clary with you. 4-2 Clemson, a lead over Cincinnati. Last night, the Tigers were up 1-0 for a long time, and then it took a four-run inning to really bust out. Today, it's been Cincinnati throwing the late punches as they're within two. And as the bottom part of this Clemson order comes up, Marty, you got to think that Monty Lee would like to see some insurance after seeing the lead whittled down to half.
Absolutely, and that's crazy how baseball is. That's why it's so different than any other sport. That line drive was a double play last inning. I mean, that could very well have been big, and then pop flies missed, but it turns into
that's
not
right.
Anyway. So crazy stuff in baseball happens all the time. And, you know, I think McCarthy really didn't give up a bunch of big hits, but just enough to whittle them away, right? But, yes, they definitely would like to see at least one insurance run here.
Gallo's reached base twice, walked and singled. Scored a run back in the fifth, a three-run fifth inning.
But what you were saying earlier, confidence when you get them out and you don't let inherited runners score, they probably are feeling pretty confident with Pandya right now with the way he pitched that inning. So, but, man, I don't know if any coach doesn't say, oh, one more would really be good right now.
You never truly satisfied.
No.
Gallo's retired for the first time today. Now Caden Grice. He walked. He was behind in the count, was able to work it into a walk back in the fifth. Well, technically a 2-2 count. Took two straight pitches, so worked an even count into a walk. Popped him up. Middle of the infield. Shortstop makes the play. Bellini gloves it for the second out.
From what I see, I think Cincinnati's going to do better than middle of the pack. Maybe not, but, I mean, you're talking about number 25 in the nation just off the top of your head and the start of a season, but they got good pitching. They throw strikes. They play good defense. Swing the bat's pretty good now that they're, you know, feeling a little more comfortable. I'm interested to see how they finish up.
It's a team that, as time's called, I think Monty Lee's going to come out and chat with home plate umpire, and I think he wants to talk with Teodosio. You know, you talked about Cincinnati. 2 years ago, they go to the NCAA tournament. They lost, I think, 9 of their first 10 games last year. They ended the season on a 7-game win streak, and so It's one of those things where you're right. I mean, you can't play baseball outside in Cincinnati in February. There's a reason the Reds are in Goodyear, Arizona right now. It's spring training. But when you do start going home, then all of a sudden your record flips and you might take your lumps early, but you can build confidence through the year. And that's something that the Bearcats, again, as you said, no matter what happens, they can take some confidence from this series against a really good high major opponent.
Absolutely. Like I said, you got pitchers that are throwing strikes, mixing up their pitches. And good defense keeps you in games. It gives you the chance to win each and every time you go on the field.
Teodosio took a beautiful backdoor breaking ball for a strike there. Trying to do it again and missed. Batcho with a little bit better command this inning. We saw him struggle with that in the sixth. Not as much here.
Could have been some of that adrenaline factor too, right? I mean, first time out, even though he's pitched to other seasons, it's fresh this year and my first chance against a quality team. You know, who's watching? Who knows?
That's right.
So I want to tick the gun and I want to get these guys out. So sometimes you overthrow a little bit.
I know there were a handful of scouts here yesterday, and who knows? Maybe a couple of them stuck around. Grounded into the third base dugout. Look out for the carom off the back wall. 1-2 to count to Teodosio, an RBI single in the fifth. Four hits already for Bryce. 4-for-6 with a run scored and RBI so far in the very, very early stages of this 2021 season. Strike three, right at the knees, and everybody knew it. Big pitch by Baccio there to get out of the bottom of the seventh. 1-2-3. The Bearcats with momentum coming to the bat in the top of the eighth in just a moment. New pitcher for the Tigers with a 4-2 lead as we head to the eighth. Clemson still sporting a lead, albeit a little bit slimmer than it was a couple innings ago. Cincinnati with one run in the sixth and one in the seventh. And now Jeffrey Gilbert trying to put up a goose egg in the eighth. Technically a freshman from Charleston. Pitched an awful lot in high leverage spots last year. This is a guy that Monty Lee says, even with guys like Pandia and Rob Hughes, a closer that transferred him from Furman in the mix, he won the closer job and looking for a six-out save, Marty.
Well, this is where you want to prove it, right? Here's the time. This is great. Nobody's on. Get to start fresh on it. And so Monty wants to see how he performs.
Joey Bellini, top of the order. Due up for the Bearcats. Bellini's 0-for-3. He's done it a variety of ways. Strikeout, ground out, fly out. And there's a base hit right through the box to start things in the top of the eighth.
And to me, that's always the difficult part for somebody coming in fresh. You want to get strikes and get ahead, but they're so geared up to a fastball at this point. They've seen a lot of fastballs all day and, you know, had a really good swing at it. Didn't look like he was, you know, off at all. So tough to come in, but you got to come in ready to mix it up. I really believe that.
Wyatt Stapp also due, 0-for-3. Leadoff man aboard. Always good for an offense. Runners going, and he fouled it back. They tried to go hit and run on the first pitch.
Yeah, not a bad thought. I mean, you know, start getting people moving, get the defense out of position a little bit. Don't have to hit it quite as good. May find a hole.
Here's a look at it. Runner takes off, and you could tell by the nature of the swing, too. That was a defensive swing just trying to make contact there. Trying to put it in play. Strike two, good pitch.
Yeah, and then, you know, the hitter gives a little, oh, come on, but that's exactly what they called on last inning on Clemson. Same type of thing. He's been pretty consistent all day. That's all you can really ask from an umpire.
O-2 pitch, Gilbert way ahead. Swing and a miss on a ball in the dirt, and he retires Stapp quickly for the first out.
Yeah, and after getting that low strike on you, it's tough to lay off that slider now, even though it's going towards the dirt, because it starts where you just got to call strike on. So good pitch by Gilbert right there.
Last year, Gilbert, 12 2/3 innings, he struck out 14. Gave up 7 hits, 7 walks, had a .71 ERA.
Love to see him start with a slider here, just a strike slider, not your best one.
Ryan Nicholson takes low. He walked his last time up on 4 pitches. You got to think the Bearcats would love to move Bellini somehow. Pretty good lead for him. Out to the cut. There's strike one.
And that's umpire vision right there. That other pitch was probably the same location, but out where the umpire leans over. Can't quite see it as good on that side of the plate. That one was about the same height level, but much more in his zone and his eyes to pick it up.
Fouls it back. One and two to Nicholson.
That hanging slider is real dangerous right there because you put it right in the wheelhouse of those big swinging lefties. Got to get a good bite on this next one.
Double play is Gilbert's best friend here. A strikeout's the next best thing. Here he comes at the 1-2. Swing and a miss. Got a little piece, but not enough to keep it out of the mid, and that's back-to-back punch outs for Gilbert.
Nice demeanor on Gilbert there. He just kind of looked him right in the eye and went up the ladder on him. Tough to hit that high fastball, especially lefty on lefty. You're in your mind, you're thinking, he's got to come breaking ball on me. Really good play by pitch by Gilbert.
And as you said, he kind of took advantage of what he did the pitch before, much like the last strikeout. He kind of hung the slider and then started the next one about the same spot. Two outs of the man at first now for Mercer. High in the air, right field. Should end the inning. Brewers got it. And the side is retired. We head to the bottom of eight. Tigers up 4-2. Good time for a game summary here today. Tigers played small ball in the first inning, got a run home. They extended the lead with a three-run fifth. There you see a tag on a sack fly, but Marty, Cincinnati didn't go away.
No, look at that. Came right back with a long ball. Teodosia had it lined up but could not hold on to it. And then two doubles down the line scored the last run.
And that brings us where we are right now, a 4-2 score. Clemson has not trailed in the first two games of this series. And you want to talk about effective wildness. While we were away, Drake Baccio managed to find the backstop a couple of different ways on his warm-up tosses, just putting that thought in the mind of every batter.
Dropped the umpire on his back as he was standing off to the side.
We'll see how Blake Wright handles it. We saw Baccio, again, struggle with command in the sixth inning when he came in relief, but in the seventh, a 1-2-3 inning, much better command, and we'll see what he comes with here in the eighth.
Yeah, everybody deserves a little grace these first times round, a little bit, especially coming out of the pen and facing somebody who's ranked in the top 25 type situation. Just gets your adrenaline going.
1-0, foul straight back. Wright drew a bases loaded walk on a 3-2 pitch. Back in that three-run fifth inning for Clemson. And one thing Monty Lee talks about a lot is the power of the crooked number. He says if you can get a crooked number, more often than not, you got a good chance to win, and he thinks with his pitching staff, all he really needs is one. You see a good swing and a miss here. Strike two.
Yeah, and there were several times where runs were given away, I think, on the base path. Cincinnati did it on the trying to go to third on the wild pitch or block ball. And then Clemson on the not really sliding into third got doubled off.
Yep.
Those were two big innings. No telling what happens when that pressure's on your defense and on your pitcher, and you make mistakes when those things happen.
1-2 the count here. I know we did see some base running miscues yesterday from Clemson that probably needed to be cleaned up. There's a pop-up from Wright. Foul territory, now back to fair territory, and a catch is made. And there again, this guy playing tricks on an infield fly ball.
There hasn't been many where they just got right up underneath it and caught it easily. They have to move late as the ball approaches the glove. It's been a challenge for the defense today.
And back to that point about base running, you could make the argument that Clemson really had four guys thrown out on the bases yesterday. Two at home on contact plays where the ball is grounded to the infield as Brewer takes high. And then they had one back picked at first base, had another one that was a double play. And then they also had a situation where there wasn't a tag at second base with nobody out. Monty Lee said, look, we got to clean that stuff up. And as you said, both teams have really got things to clean up in that regard from the game today. And some of that is just early season, trying to get your sea legs underneath you and trying to let your brain match your activity.
Yeah, and how many of these guys are first-time players?
Yes.
At this level? I mean, it's a lot going on in them emotionally and trying to keep everything intact and give their best effort. So they'll clean it up by the end of midseason and start a conference play. They'll have it the way they want it, or or they're going to tear some hide. I'll just be honest with you. That's what's going to happen.
Well put. 3-0 count to Dylan Brewer. Walked three times yesterday, and a sac fly today has yet to reach. Rio pitched to him way up high. Tigers, again, up a couple of runs here with a win. They win the series. And, you know, in our business, it's never too early to look ahead to a big rivalry weekend series. And that's what we've got next weekend. You can catch the first of three between Clemson and South Carolina right here on ACC Network Extra, 4 o'clock. On Friday afternoon, jumping right into a big rivalry series before the start of March.
Means a lot in this state, too. They just love it. They love battling each other. And I don't care what you are coming into it, it's going to be a battle.
I like to have some of those things, some of those kinks ironed out before you face a really good Gamecocks team who played very well yesterday in their opener against Dayton. Elijah Henderson trying to get on base. He drove in a run in the first with a ground out. But has yet to get on base with a walk this season or a hit. He was hit by a pitch one time yesterday. A quite capable hitter and a versatile defender who spent the last 2 days in left field. Half a swing. Did he go? He did not. Close pitch, and then he had the close check swing. Let's take another look at it. Pretty close.
Flip a coin.
Yep.
Right? I mean, he called it right off the bat. Didn't hesitate, so got to give it to him.
Runner moving. Henderson takes the throw down, goes into center field. The Brewer swipes a bag and puts a man in scoring position with one out now. Here's another shot of Brewer heading down to second.
I think if he catches that, they might have him. If that throws just another foot in length.
Had a play like that yesterday where a throw down short hop the second baseman. And as you said, if it hadn't, then it might have been a different story. As it stands, a 3-1 count now on Elijah Henderson. Rip straight back. He got the pitch he was looking for there.
I think he's seeing Batcho's got the live arm, but he also has the Jekyll and Hyde kind of, you know, four ball straight, throw real good at bat to the next guy, you know, in the dirt. If he picks that up a little bit and gets his mechanics right.
There's one of those overthrows for ball four in the dirt. Trying to make the perfect pitch that time. Not the first time we've seen it today, either way.
Yeah, he's definitely gotta iron out some of his mechanics a little bit so that he's a little more consistent through his innings from batter to batter, because he's got a really nice arm.
Two on, one out for James Parker. Best rally Clemson's put forth really since that fifth inning where they scored three times. In fact, that's the only other time in the game where Clemson's had multiple runners on base. And now time's called. We're going to get a trip to the mound. This is a critical juncture in the game now, and Cincinnati does have some work ongoing in the bullpen. It looks like 43, Zach Siegel, who has just left the premises out there. I just saw him come back in the dugout, and he looks like he's ready to go. Let's see what the decision is here. Are they going to stick with the lefty Bacho, or are they going to go? And they will go and make the change. Once again, the Bearcats go to the bullpen. Bacho, as you said, Jekyll and Hyde, but more good than bad. And we'll tell you about the man who will replace him after this. Sophomore right-hander Zach Siegel on the mound now for the Bearcats. You see him from Loveland, Ohio, 6'1", 170. He comes into the game in the stead of Drake Bacho, who had faced 10 batters. So particularly for guys coming out of the bullpen, you see a guy second time. He had just seen Henderson for the second time. He walked Parker already once, so you're kind of making a bit of an upside play here with Siegel coming in, particularly with right-handed bats like Parker and French and Hawkins and Gallo coming right down the pipe.
Yeah, and he was his, you know, worst enemy at some point and his best in the others. I mean, he caught that line drive. It could have been a big inning.
Yes.
You know, he stopped that and shut it down, but he gave runners as well, you know, four balls in a row, et cetera. So just wasn't super sharp. But I like him. I like his arm strength. I like his movement. So just needs to kind of shore that up as the season goes. Siegel here, he drops down a little bit. It's going to be a little tougher on these righties to stay in there. He's the kind of guy that can accidentally jam you because you just can't pick it up quick enough, and it looks like it's coming from behind your head. So good move by Cincinnati.
Siegel, we said he's a sophomore Ohioan. 5 appearances out of the pen last year. 8 1/3 innings, a 5.40 ERA. First pitch is right in there for a strike to Parker. And it's a tough guy to get out regardless. When you got to come right in with two guys on and get him out, it really ratchets up the intensity here, particularly with the Bearcats still within striking distance, down 2.
Yeah, he's going to be consistently throwing that sidearm slider and making it real difficult to make good contact. But if you do hit that slider and you sit back on it, you can drive it right through where second base is pinching in for the middle. Right there.
Ripped to right, coming on and making the catch, the right fielder. Couldn't dilly-dally on that. Comastec had to have a beat on it off the bat, and he did to make the running catch. Worth another look.
Tremendous at-bat, though. I mean, Parker did everything you can do. Took the pitch away, hit a line drive, just right at somebody.
Now Jonathan French. He's 0-for-3 today. Didn't reach on a fielder's choice his last time. Really, he popped up to the second baseman and the ball was dropped. Ended up being a force at second base, one of those things that happens sometimes. French hit the big 3-run home run last night. Broke the game open. And here he grounds one to left for a hit. Let's see if the Tigers can get a run. Here comes Brewer. The throw in is cut off. And there's that insurance run for the Tigers to extend the lead to 5-2. And Jonathan French has now driven in 4 runs on the weekend.
Yeah, really good piece of hitting. He took advantage of that hanging slider rather than that real good sharp one. Punch it through the hole. Not a good throw from your left fielder there. He needed to carry the plate, and they would have had a chance, but he buried it in the ground, one hopped it to the first baseman. So Clemson was going all the way to try and get that run. So a good one to push across.
Now Briar Hawkins, 1-for-3. He's the one that lined out to the pitcher and had the unfortunate double play. Oh, a big swing on a breaker. Hawkins and Pierce Gallo and Caden Grice, the next three guys up, all scored back in the fifth inning. You see the numbers for Hawkins.
I don't know if you could hear Monty Lee under the crowd there, but he's telling them exactly what we were talking about. Slider, 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 slider.
And there's a fastball, a little bit high. Wonder if Siegel heard him too.
Well, you know, I don't know what they can or can't hear, but we could definitely hear that game mic up here, him talking. You know, that's the difference with 1,200 versus 6,000.
Ripped down the line. That's going to be foul out of play up on the porch.
And they're definitely sitting on that. They're looking for it. If he throws that fastball inside, they'll never hit it because they're looking out and away, trying to catch that slider coming across the plate. This is where you got to match your strength with a secondary pitch that really matches it to hard inside versus that sweeping slower one. So if he can hit with that, I think he'll get him.
Went further away. 2-2.
Staying slider. I don't think he has the confidence necessarily to come inside hard like that.
Well, to your point, you mentioned that plan A would be to pound inside. Plan B is just go further away, right?
Yep. Yep. And hope they swing.
He tried that time and is fouled up and out of play.
That fastball was a little more middle of the plate. Had he gotten in that inner third, he either chops it or swings right over top of it.
Just peeking ahead to the top half of the ninth inning, where Cincinnati is going to have to overcome at least a three-run deficit. They'll have 5, 6, 7 in the order. Santiago, Merritt, and Holen do up against, we presume, Jeffrey Gilbert. And a check swing, but the ball comes into play. Santiago with all the time in the world to throw him out. And the side's retired. A little excuse me swing from Hawkins, and he's upset. Once again, a good development for the Bearcats in the field as Hawkins, whoopsie-daisy, puts it in play. Tigers 3 outs away from a win as we head to the ninth. To the ninth we go, and the Bearcats down by 3. You see the progression of things. It was all Clemson for a while. Tigers built a 4-0 lead, that big insurance run in the last half inning. As we take a look at the Bearcats, they'll finish up with Clemson tomorrow. And then, as you said, they're going to wait till mid-March to play a home game. They've got some interesting dates coming up with Western Kentucky and UNCW. We're heading home for Western Michigan and Xavier. Back to the action is Jeffrey Gilbert looking for a 6-out save. Misses up and away on Santiago, ball one.
Don't want to get cute here. Just relax. Pound the strike zone. Let your defense play behind you.
Right down the middle, a strike there on Santiago, who's got a couple of hits today and a run scored.
A lot of time there will be a take a strike type situation anyways, so go ahead and get it in there.
Threw him another one and he fouled it back, 1-2.
That one had real good location and started tailing too, just off the plate. Could not get good contact on it.
Gilbert ahead of Santiago. Just an 11-pitch inning where Gilbert allowed a leadoff single and then went strikeout, strikeout, flyout to end it with no damage done. You see Gilbert, again, technically a freshman, but a guy who threw quite a bit out of the bullpen a year ago. Swing and a tip into the mitt. And that's 3 strikeouts for Gilbert in an inning in the third.
That ball explodes when he gets it up a little bit. That's going to be a good two-strike pitch for him. That just kind of tailed and went up and away from him. And just if he can really master that location, that's going to be a tough pitch for any hitter.
Tigers two outs away now. Griffin Merritt stands in. High fly ball back into right. Brewer over at the edge of the track will make the catch for the second out. A look at what's ahead now for the Tigers after this one. They've got Cincinnati obviously tomorrow, then the aforementioned South Carolina series, a midweek day with East Tennessee State, and then bam, right into conference play.
Yeah, it's time, man. Let's get her going. They missed all of last year pretty much. Let's get her done. So it's going to be good.
Looking forward to that series with Notre Dame. But first things first, a win today. Get the series. Tigers will look for the sweep tomorrow, and then all their attention will be focused on that series with the Gamecocks. Tanner Hull in the last lifeline for the Bearcats. He's 0 for 3. Line shot, and the game will continue. Good piece of hitting, and it's misplayed out in the outfield, and Holland will take the extra base. So the Tigers played 17 errorless innings to start this series, and then a snafu out in right center field leads to the first error of the season. Check out what happened here.
So he makes the beat on and just took his eye off, was already looking where the runner was, and never saw the ball into the glove and just bounced off of it. So not overly crucial at this time. However, not a thing that the coach wants to see.
Cincinnati had the one error yesterday. Clemson the one error today thus far. Otherwise, really pretty defense being played right here as time's called. Two teams with, and Marty, you've talked about it several times today, Cincinnati's shown a propensity for very good defense, and Clemson likewise at times today. Here's Murray, 1 for 3. Pitch from Gilbert. Oh, he paints the black. 0-1.
And throwing strikes, both teams. I've had some walks, but for the most part, for this early in the season, to be able to throw that many strikes with that few walks is a good sign.
Swing and a miss. Well, he pulled the string on him that time. 0-2.
Yeah, now don't get cute. Go ahead and just try and put it away.
Gilbert pitched well last year, never got a save. Opportunity for his first career as the crowd rises to its feet here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium. And a long look in was too long for Jake Murray. He got tired of waiting. Gilbert with a chance to end it. He does. Tigers win it 5-2 and take this series over the Cincinnati Bearcats, and that little man is going home a happy camper today. A fantastic job of pitching for really the last 2 days for the Tigers, and specifically here, Jeffrey Gilbert. 6 straight outs to close the ball game.
And finishes him on that high fastball that can be so difficult to hit with 2 strikes because you can't lay off it. It's not a strike, but you can't stop your bat because you see it so good. So great job by Clemson right there in their pitching.
Final score again, 5-2. The Tigers, much like yesterday, built the lead at the beginning, expanded it in the middle, and then today they got a little pushback from the Bearcats, but the bullpen held strong, and Monty Lee's team is 2-0. Thanks to our crew here at Clemson. For my broadcast partner, Marty Clary, I'm William Quackenbush saying so long from Doug Kingsmore Stadium today. We'll see you next time right here on ACC Network.